Thank you. And thank you for the invitation. So, Keith said that we went for the same meeting in the bank for the first time in Montevideo, but Keith already came 8 times here. So I have some catching up to do because I came only 6 times. But it's very hard because each time I come, he's there already. So what my setup is compact, a closed. Closed Riemannian manifold with negative sectional curvature, and you know that the geodesic flow is Anosov, and the object of interest is one object of interest, if you want, is a central stable manifold, central stable foliation of the unit tangent bundle. So have the unit tangent bundle, spherical tangent bundle. The unit tangent bundle is have the geodesic flow. The geodesic flow is Anosov, and there is a central stable foliation. And the dimension of the leaves is the same as the dimension of the manifold. And you might be interested in the, I mean, you have a foliation on a compact space, and it's transitive, right? It go, leaves are, and they go everywhere, and it's a very nice foliation, but the leaves are. So you wonder whether there is some ergodic theory always of such an object, which goes everywhere and mixes everything. But there is no natural mapping. I mean, there is one. There is one flow which preserves, of course, the geodesic flow preserves the central stable foliation. So I have the geodesic flow, so it's bar, the geodesic spray. So X bar is tangent to is tangent to the to X bar at X is tangent to WCS. But of course, it's higher dimensional, so it's much richer than that. So you want something which takes into account all the direction. And the natural object is the Laplacian, because locally, the central stable foliation is the same, is identified with the space. So you have a metric on the space, you can leave the metric on the leaves. So you have a metric on the space, so you have what we call delta CS, which will be the divergence of, I mean, the divergence of F. And makes sense for F, which is smooth, or C2, in C2 even, along WCS. I don't care much. I mean, transversally, it's only, I mean, I have coefficient, which depend on the metric. And in all the talk, C infinity. The metric will be C infinity. But nevertheless, transversally, it's only Hölder continuous, but it's continuous. It's already not so bad. And I have these operators on the leaf, and I have some, now I have some dynamics because I have the diffusion associated to the Laplacian. And what I want to consider is not only the Laplacian, but mix the two, and I will call L lambda, which is that operator, delta CS, plus lambda X. So it's an operator which is very nice along the leaf, but globally it's not nice. I mean, it's It takes into account only the derivatives along the leaves. Nevertheless, you can ask whether so you are on a compact space, you have an operator which looks like elliptic. I mean, it's not elliptic, but it's elliptic at least in a few directions. So you can ask whether there are invariant probability measures. So what does that mean? We say that M lambda is stationary if for all F smooth along C2 of WCS, C2, smooth C2 along the leaves, and the germs, two germs are continuous globally. So I want that for all functions like that, if I apply my generator of my diffusion, I get zero. So it's the invariance for e to the t lambda, the diffusion, which is e to the t lambda, L lambda. Okay, so that's the notion of stationary measure, and it's quite old. I mean, it has been studied already. I mean, so for lambda equals zero, that's just, you don't take into account the geodesic spray. And that's general for a for a foliation. You can always talk about the Brinian the diffusion along the foliation and stationary measure. In that case, they are called harmonic measure. And for the for the central stable foliation, it was chosen by Garnett, Lucy Garnett, in 83, that there exists a unique M naught, which is stationary for delta L0. And more or less, she knows, she describes a little, she describes L naught, M naught sufficiently. So locally, you have the leaf of, so that the leaf of your foliation, and you. And you have, I mean, it's bigger than the transversal one. it's not very realistic, but so this is n, this is dimension n, this is dimension n minus 1, as you can see. And locally, you know the density, the conditional measure of M0. Are of the form, are proportional, anyway, conditional measure are defined up to some coefficient, to kx, kxy dy. So you have the Lebesgue measure because you have the metric, you have the Lebesgue measure on the leaf, and you have k, and k are harmonic functions. And you have delta CS y of k xy equals zero. So that's one example which is well known. Another one which is well known is for so if I take if I call V the volume entropy.
What is x k xy?
Some function on because it's up to some it's proportional.
No, which is what?
So I have a density here, I have a density here. The only thing I can say is the ratio between the density here and the density. And the density is, the ratio is kxy.
No, but
François,
I think you're asking about which is the x coordinate and which is y.
Doesn't matter. Okay, I fix the x and as a function of y on the leaf. Yeah, but it's a it's a cocycle. So if you take another x, it will be the same function up to some constant, which will be exactly k of x x prime. It's long to describe. So yeah. Okay, so the volume entropy of M, which is V is the limit R 1 over R log of the volume of the ball in the universal cover of radius R. That's, as you know, it's also the topological entropy of the of the geodesic flow. So if I take lambda equal V, there is also, that's something which I did some time ago, there is also unique stationary measure for LV. And that measure has many names. It's the Bourget, for people who know, the Bourget-Roblin measure. It's also the Knipper measure, the one you put, you take the sphere, you take the stable, you lift the sphere to the universal cover by putting the stable direction. This you transform and you get a limit of as R go to infinity. This gives you a family of you look at the measure, you look at the limit R go to infinity, give you some measure on the quotient. That's also maybe it's also so the conditional measures are also proportional, are also you see, but here it's much nicer. It's e to the minus v, the Boosman function of x, y. So it's not the nicest way of describing it. The nicest way of describing it is to say that it's the conditional measure on the strong stable manifold are proportional to Lebesgue. So it's and transversely, it is the unique measure which is invariant by the strong stable manifold. So it's nice. It's a nice measure also. So very, very natural. And a little later, it's for all lambda smaller than V, it was shown by Amenstadt in 97. The same result, there exists a unique M lambda stationary. For L lambda. For lambda smaller than V. For lambda bigger than V, there are plenty of. And you have this conditional measure on of M lambda are proportional to some function, k lambda x, y, dy. And k lambda satisfies some relation. So I have delta s in y of k lambda x, y plus minus lambda divergence yes of x of k lambda times x equals zero. There you have some equation like that, which is satisfied by the conditional measure. Again, I take the derivative in y, and it does not depend on x because it's but the fact that it's zero does not depend on x because if you change x, you multiply by a constant in y, and it's the ratio of the density when each time you take a real conditional measure. Okay, so that's what is known. And so the result I want to talk about today so the theorem. So it's work, in preparation, it's more than work in progress, but it's not completely written. is what happens when lambda goes to infinity. As lambda goes to minus infinity, m lambda goes to the Liouville measure. So, what happens when, there is one example, constant curvature or locally symmetric spaces. That's the example, not much to say, that's so example zero. M is locally symmetric with negative curvature. Then, M lambda is Liouville measure for all lambda. And conversely, it's not very, very hard to see that if for one lambda, m lambda is the Liouville measure, then you look at what it means for that function both to be the going from one point to another. You have the Jacobian. If it is a Liouville measure, you know how it changes with the flow. Is a Jacobian, and you know this equation. So you have sufficiently many equations to conclude that. To conclude that the mean curvature of the holosphere, the delta of the Boosman function, is constant, and that's by many people, the French crowd, implies it's locally symmetric. So, locally symmetric is the same as M lambda, Liouville measure for all lambda and for one lambda. And in for surfaces, there is a very, very nice phenomenon, is that M is locally symmetric, M is constant curvature. As soon as M0 is equivalent to M lambda. That's a famous result by Katok. So it's M0 equal Liouville implies locally symmetric. That's easy to see. So what very nice result of Katok is that M0 is equivalent, has the same negligible set as Liouville, M is equivalent to Liouville. This implies already that you have constant curvature. But of course, you use a conformal equivalent. I mean if you have any metric in dimension 2, it's conformally equivalent to a metric of constant curvature. And then you see that the entropy of. If this amounts to say that the entropy of the Liouville measure is the same as the V, and then you see that it's not. I mean, there is some Cauchy-Schwarz somewhere. And you have the same kind of result for surfaces for the other measures. Same for M0, no, MV. MV, so MV equivalent to M. Or M0 equivalent to M. V equivalent to M or M0 equivalent to MV. What do I say? Ketok is a measure of maximal entropy, UV has maximal entropy. So the other one is the harmonic measure has maximal dimension. And what's remaining? The M0 equivalent to M. So that's true also for in dimension 2 only. And that's, I mean, I did it, but Ketok also did it in the late 80s. Once you have the idea of Ketok, it's just a small modification of it. And there are conjectures, of course, that's still true in higher dimension. So for, and the conjecture have names. For so in higher dimension, so M V equivalent to M implies locally symmetric. That was of course conjectured by Ketok after this result. But in fact, the other one had been conjectured before, even if they didn't have the so M0 equivalent to MV implies locally symmetric was conjectured by Sullivan. Because, yeah, I didn't say that MV is also related to Patterson-Sullivan contraction. So. And actually, M0 equivalent to M was implies locally symmetric was even conjectured earlier by Leon Green. Anyway, these are conjecture. And very little is known about them. It's still open in all dimensions. The only thing which is known is a result by Livio Flaminio. Is Ketok conjecture holds. In a neighborhood of a constant curvature. So the local version is true. Around the constant curvature, you cannot have the UV measure have maximal entropy, which is another form of that's the, as far as I know, that's the only positive result. So what our results say? Well, we couldn't do anything with it, but it's fresh, so still hope. In some sense, we interpolate with between M and MV, the whole family, not only with M0, but with the whole family of measure. So we can try to follow the different quantities along the parameter lambda. It doesn't work. I mean, there is something we want to be increasing, but non-decreasing, but it's not clear it is. But well, that was basically the idea that behind this. And what do I want to say? I want to say a few words about the proof. Do you want to say something else? So the proof is, yeah, I mean, what happens? What happens when lambda goes to minus infinity? Well, I just erased it, but the equation is integral of delta plus lambda, delta CS plus lambda, F dm lambda equals zero. Or I can, so lambda goes to minus infinity, so I can epsilon minus 1 over lambda. So what do I have? Is minus x, if I divide by plus epsilon delta CS, F Vm lambda equals 0. So in some sense, and epsilon goes to 0 now. So in some sense, it's a perturbation of minus six. So you expect any weak, I mean, you are in a compact space, so you have a weak star limit of the measure. So you know that any weak star limit measure will be invariant under the geodesic flow. So that's already something, any weak star limit is invariant until minus 6 bar invariant. So invariant by the reverse geodesic flow, but which is also invariant by the geodesic flow, the same. And I erase what you know about the M lambda is that the conditional measure on the unstable manifold are nice. I mean, they are given by something which satisfies an equation which I just erased here. Delta of k lambda plus lambda minus lambda d of k lambda x equals 0. But the problem, so you have, for such an equation, you have a Harnack inequality. So along the leaf, k lambda is quite regular. So it's good, I mean, it's regular. We have many examples of that, right? We have Piacine-Sinai or U-state, and we have many examples of, we have a family of measures which are regular along the central stable manifold. They go to the limit, it's still regular. The only one which is absolute continuous is Lebesgue. Except that, if I'm not mistaken, the sign is wrong. So when lambda goes to infinity, you still have Harnack inequality, but it's worse and worse. So the estimate that you have on the regularity of log k lambda is disappear when lambda goes to infinity. I mean, it's intuitive, right? I mean, you have less and less influence of the noise. So what you know, when you take the whole Laplacian, that's also classical. It's Kiefer in the 70s, who shows that the limit as epsilon goes to zero of something like that is the Liouville measure, or the Sinai-Bauerhein measure in the case of in the non-conservative case. But here we have something which is not elliptic. We cannot use Kiefer ideas because we have good estimate for delta, but only along the stable. And then epsilon goes to zero, we have good estimate on the neighborhood on the central stable manifold, doesn't go very far. So the idea is to try to use a thermodynamic formalism to try to characterize Liouville by the entropy. And this has been done also in the case of the entropy of what? That's the question. But the idea is that if you have a diffusion like that, there is a way of taking a bigger space and thinking of it as a projection of a family of random diffeomorphism. So we will do dynamics, but random dynamics. Random dynamics means you have a family you have a family of diffeomorphism of your manifold, and each time you make a random walk, if you want, on the diffeomorphism of the group. Of the group of diffeomorphism of the manifold. You choose a diffeomorphism, do it at random with some distribution, and then you choose another one at random with the same distribution. And for each path, in fact, you have very nice, if the f are close to the hyperbolic thing, for each path, you have very nice hyperbolic sequences, and you can do hyperbolic dynamics. Path by path. Okay, it's not as, you have to construct the guy, and when you construct the guy, you realize it's not as nice as that, but that's the idea.
So what? So there are four steps. So four steps. So the first one would be to construct a random dynamics. which will have two properties which will be so which that preserves WS. WCS, because that's what you want. I mean, the randomness is only on WCS, and it's somehow which is related somehow to L lambda. Maybe be a little more precise. But now that you have a random dynamics, there is a notion of random entropy. Random Lyapunov exponent, and for that random dynamics, we just have to show that Pearson formula, that the H is bigger than the integral of log GS dm lambda. You have to define H, but the thing which makes the idea work is that what is it on the universal tangent? An universal cover of the space. One leaf of a leaf is all the geodesics which converge to the same point. So now on that I do the Laplacian, which is the Laplacian on M tilde plus lambda x, and lambda is very negative. So what do I do? I go this way. I go very far from that. And then I do a small perturbation, a big spawn and a small perturbation, big spawn and a small perturbation, and so on. So WCS is invariant by the construction, so it will be something like the unstable manifold of this random thing. It's a very nice random family because you have some foliation which is invariant and which really has the same property of the unstable because you are close to minus six. So GS is a Jacobian in the direction of the, along W, GSC is a Jacobian along WSC, which in the random world will mean the unstable manifold. Not unstable, central unstable. Or something. Anyway, it's big. And then you saw that HM lambda. Then this guy you just will be a limit. What do I want? I want to have a Pearson formula at the end, so I want a log GSC dm is smaller than the limit lambda goes to minus infinity of integral of log GSC dm lambda. Well, that's you have to do the construction in a way which is all the elements are continuous when lambda goes to minus infinity. But that's what people who do that kind of construction know how to do. And the last step, which is the most important, is that to show that the entropy is at least the limit sup, the entropy of 4 phi minus 1. Is at least the lim sup at lambda goes to minus infinity of this h lambda, h of m lambda, which I which I have not defined yet. And so it's a question of upper semi-continuity of the entropy. Right? But this has been done by Yomdin. and busy. And okay, you have to adjust in that circumstances. But you, we are in a good shape because we have Sinfinity mapping, which preserves WCS. And this entropy, which I give you the definition in a moment, only involves how your dynamics acts on WCS. So your Yundin arguments are essentially correct. I mean, essentially adaptable. But it has been done in the case of by Colfisson and Lai Sang-Yang. It has been done in the case where to get the Kiefer result in the case of perturbation, random perturbation of an Ossoff diffeo. So we are not in the same situation. We have much weaker hypothesis, but okay, all points can be, hopefully, I mean, so far, can be taken care of. So maybe I explain. Maybe I explain the construction of the random dynamics. I mean, there are two points. The construction of the random dynamics, it's classical, but maybe it's not well known in the audience. And Keith already made the picture for me, so. And that part, I'll try to say a few words. And the definition of the entropy, that's classical. So what is how do you construct a random dynamics with some diffusion operator like it was realized by essentially Malliavin and other people behind him that what you have to do is you have to go to the autonomous frame bundle. And on the autonomous frame bundle, there is a natural way of constructing random dynamics which project back to such as the trajectory. If you look at the so it's a random product, as I said, and if you look at the trajectory, they project back on the trajectory of the diffusion with the right probability space.
The stationary measure for the random dynamics is the same.
You lift it. I mean, so you go on the frame bundle. Okay, there are small little problems. Okay, so how do you? So crash course on stochastic flows. How do you construct the Brownian motion on Rm? So you take delta, so you're starting from zero. You take a small delta. And you choose a direction at random, and you go up to square root of delta in that direction. That gives you a small geodesic here. So you go straight line here, and you go. You choose again at random on the sphere of direction, and you go at square root of delta, and you continue like this. And the old theorem of Kolmogorov, for instance, is that when delta goes to zero, the distribution of this path converges to some distribution on paths, which, of course, are only one half order. And, and that's the construction of the Brownian motion on Rm in one word, one picture. And the wonderful observation of Malliavin is that you can do the same to construct a diffusion. So I have my generator. So now what do I need? I need some mapping. So the diffusion will be on OS of OSC of SM tilde. I do it on the on the universal cover because there will be some problem when you go to the quotient. But a priori, I do it on a universal cover. And this is the space of orthonormal frame. Tangent to WCS. And I do the same. If I start from some element here, u, so it's u. I start from u, u which belongs to TV of no, I start from a frame, sorry. I start from a frame, yeah, u, which belongs to TV of. So I need a way to map my RM into the space of frame. So I teach points in TSM. I have E1, E2, EM, and I know what they are, and I can do it in a smooth way. So now if I take one of these frames, I do the same. Here I choose one direction, so I choose one direction, and I do parallel transport, like the same picture as in Keith's talk. I do a parallel transport for a time square root of delta along that direction. And if I want to have a lambda x, so I put, and if I have lambda x, I also put delta bar. I have parallel transport along the geodesic for a length delta. So I arrive here, I started with a u, I have another u here, and my mapping tells me that the second one, how I choose my geodesic here. So I choose my geodesic here by the image of this one, square root of delta, and delta x bar, and so on. And the same proof of Kolmogorov tells you that this converges for almost every choice of at each step you choose and you put everything in the same probability space, the same as the one we had convergence here, and for almost every choice you have a path, a continuous path at the end, which is as there as before, and the projection on so it's a path on the space of frames, but essentially if you change a frame you go elsewhere, but you also have a frame, and if you start with Lebesgue measure on the frames, it's invariant under that process. It's stationary under that process. And so it gives you a path, and the distribution of the path are the distribution of the diffusion associated with that generator.
Is that lambda delta? Mm-hmm. There is no lambda.
Lambda. The nice thing from that construction, I mean, it needs a proof, but it's common sense, is that, okay, I start from one u and I start from one leaf. But if I take a leaf nearby, it's continuous. Right? If I have my xi, and I have another xi prime, and I do my construction, and moreover, I mean, you have to check that indeed, for lambda smaller than v, it goes far away. I mean, it goes to infinity, so it doesn't go toward xi. So since it goes far away from that point, I mean, everything is very close, and it's even closer and closer. So what you construct here is continuous in xi. Continuous is in epsilon for the same reason. I mean, if you change epsilon or lambda, it will be, I mean, it will be close here, it will be a little bigger, but if you take a finite path, it will be. And so for almost every trajectory here, you have not only a trajectory here, but you have really a flow. And we have really a map from the, so I go to the limit, so I have something like that, and I have really a map from u here, to the tangent space, to the frame. And the map depends, I mean, the construction of the map, say, up to time one, depends only on what I did in tab up to time one here. So I'm really composing independent map. So not only have, So this gives you much more, this gives you really a random walk on, even a random process, on the space of diffeomorphism of your space, of the orthogonal tangent, orthogonal frame bundle. And that's, okay, that's 80s, Malliavin, Bismuth, Elworthy. But the nice thing is that it tells you that because of that, this you can do for any stochastic differential equation. So the nice model for random perturbation is random diffeos. Because if you want to make a continuous analog, that's the only way of doing it. Of course, discrete, you can make a Markov chain where each step is close to the image. But if you want to make a continuous analog, that's the only way of doing it. So that's my advertisement. I mean, stochastic flow is the only way. I mean, if you go now to discrete time, random perturbation is a natural way, random diffeos is a natural way of making a random perturbation of a diffeo. It seems to be a little far-fetched a priori, but because of that, and random diffeo are much more easy. I mean, trajectory by trajectory, you can do dynamics. I mean, it's just non-autonomous dynamics. But if you have cones, you have cones, and sometimes they are destroyed. But you have some estimate of how often that. I mean, it's really a dynamics. Just that you repeat, but you don't repeat always the same thing. So in particular, you have some entropy. So what I said about the continuity in lambda, it's also true when lambda goes to minus infinity. So the trajectory are really closer and closer to the trajectory of the guy when you don't do anything, so which is the frame flow. The frame flow for the space of a frame over the central stable manifold. So so this guy, I mean, it needs to be checked, but there is no obstacle. There is no. Okay, so I want to talk about. So that's what I explain, maybe. So what is the entropy? To define the entropy, you define a Bowen ball. So what is the entropy? I have diff of so it's OS of TM OCS of TM to the N and have a product measure on that. So at each stage I take at random one of this. So a typical sequence is phi 0, phi 1 so on phi n with the product measure. And now for such a sequence, I can define the stable relative Bowen ball, which will be bs of u. So I start with some u, I have my sequence, I have some number eta, and I have some integer n. And I look at all the W in the same frame space, such that the distance between so phi 0, phi 1, phi n minus 1 of omega, everything depends on the sequence of U and phi 0. Phi k minus 1, phi k minus 1, phi 1, phi 0 of W is smaller than eta for k between 0 and n. That's exactly the definition of the Bowen ball. And we take the thing, we take only elements in the same space, I mean the space we are of interest, or the we take orthonormal frame above, which are tangent to the central stable many. And otherwise, it's the same definition as the usual Bowen ball. And just the Baditi-Weier ergodic theorem, or what, I mean, it's not very hard to see that, to define H M HM of phi bar U, which is the limb N minus 1 over N log of M, so M lambda. For us is M lambda, the stationary measure. Ah. I have a stationary measure on the space on the SM. So I want a stationary measure on the frame boundary. But there is one way of doing it, is just to put a Lebesgue measure on all the fibers. So that's M bar lambda. So M bar lambda of B S U phi eta N, and we take the limit. Eta go to zero. That's the that's Bowen definition of the entropy, and it works. It's a additive, and along I mean, it's random. It's random, but it's a additive along the sequence. And again, the way they are defined, they preserve WCS. I mean, I didn't say it explicitly, but I worked in WCS, so I define a diffeomorphism of the manifold, but which preserves the central stable foliation. So I have a central stable foliation, but I know also, and I can look at the central stable foliation and saturate by the fibers. And I know that the conditional measures are absolutely continuous because they saturate in the they are absolutely continuous in the projection. That's the property of M lambda. And I put Lebesgue on the fiber. So the conditional measure absolutely continuous, that's Piessine formula. This is Piessine formula for the random thing, which I think, okay, it's not exact, but Aaron Brown, for instance, as a proof of the Piessine formula in that case. I mean, it's really a random partial foliation and random diffeos. I mean, it's the utmost generalization of Piessine formula. Okay, so we are in good shape. We just have to check that. And maybe I'm saved by the gong, but. Great. Those are two propositions to prove. That's where the. I mean, all that was. It's a little painful by moments, but. Okay, so the trick now, we have the relative Bowen balls, and we have also the notion of a Bowen conditional entropy. I don't know if you know that. Which we can adapt in that case. How many letters I have? I fix a rho positive and a sequence as before, and I call R of what? Rho phi bar U eta N. The number the number of B S W phi bar sem eta sem n balls needed, minimal number needed to cover the Bowen ball B S U phi bar eta. So I fix rho. I fix my rho, and I look. I'm interested in the dispersion of the upper semi-continuity of the entropy. The entropy will be very nice, very continuous if I fix the size of the rho. If it fails, it might fail to be upper semi-continuous in when it's because something strange happens when rho goes to zero. So you just take a topological invariant, which was introduced by Bowen, which is called the conditional. So conditional was not a good word, but since now we have relative, so it's a conditional stable relative. Entropy, which will be what? H of phi bar u is lim lambda. No, H of rho phi bar will be the sup over u. It's a topological object. Given the random sequence, it's a topological object. The sup over u of lim eta goes to zero of lim sup and 1 over n. R of rho phi u eta n. Okay, that's a topological number which measure how the random diffeo brings some entropy even at a very very small scale. If you know the scale, the entropy at scale rho, but maybe it's not enough to know the whole entropy. And this is measured by some number. And that number is, it depends on the sequence, but it depends on the sequence in a stationary way. So if I have some lambda, so for lambda bigger than minus infinity, h rho phi is almost everywhere constant. Because it depends on phi, the sequence of independent object, but it's stationary. So I call this object H lambda of rho phi. And the two propositions we have to prove are one which says that we can control this object, and the other one which says that the defect of upper semi-continuity is exactly that object. Statement. So the first proposition is that HM of the reverse geodesic flow. That the lim sup lambda goes to minus infinity of H lambda, HM lambda, the guy we define, is smaller than HM of phi minus 1 plus the defect, and the defect comes from here. The defect is lim rho goes to 0 of lim sup lambda goes to minus infinity of rho of h rho lambda. Constant, it does not depend on phi. H lambda of rho. Okay, so that's the first proposition. And the second proposition is that this guy is zero. Okay, so what is behind this?
This proposition will be a particular case of a general phenomenon or no?
So Bowen introduced this condition that non-random. So H of rho goes to zero.
For
a diffeomorphism. To show that as a condition for upper semi-continuity of the entropy, upper semi-continuity of the topological entropy, the neighborhood of the diffeom. So, but it's just, I mean, it's just, that's the question. And this one, maybe that's the most interesting, was done by Yomdin when he for C-infinity manifold, when he proved the entropy conjecture for C-infinity manifold by showing that there is no, and it was interpreted by Jérôme Bouzy, is really a theorem of upper semi-continuity of the entropy for C-infinity diffeos. For C-infinity diffeos, the entropy, the application measure goes to entropy of the measure, is upper semi-continuous. And the proof is that. And how do you prove that? The Yomdin, it's topological argument, it's topological object. And what is the topological object is the biggest growth of a submanifold. And if you take a submanifold and you look at how much you apply your diffeomorphism, how much it can grow in a ball while staying in a ball of radius rho. So you take a submanifold, you apply it, and each time you intersect with a ball of radius rho. If this is controlled, then the entropy is upper semi-continuous. And how this is controlled, that's a wonderful idea of Yomdin, for C-infinity case, you approximate by a polynomial. And the control will be eventually as the derivative divided by R. Log as a derivative. For a diffeomorphism, the lack of upper semi-continuity of the entropy is exactly the log of the Lipschitz constant divided by the regularity. So if you are C-infinity, the regularity is infinite, and it's zero. Okay, you have to do this in that setting where it's not uniform, it's random, but it's essentially the same. It's longer, but most of the steps which I think might be problem, we check them. But okay, maybe writing completely, there would be new surprise. But a priori, I'm confident that it's true, and I can stop here. Yeah, I assume it's infinite. I assume the manifold is infinity. The central stable foliation is infinity. And those guys are infinity, but the... Okay, I have the impression of using a hammer to kill a fly, but it's not really clear how to make a counterexample, but... We haven't really looked at it because it's quite fresh material. What is? That this guy is zero. So that.
But no one will be able to know.